CCAC, who always talked about the Canadian Council that I'm on here, they separate out purpose and animal use. And one of the purposes of animal use is use in education and training. The numbers, the most recent ones I could find were 2011, that's 157,105 animals used in education in the year 2011. There was missing data from 2010 rather, but in 2009 there was 126,127 animals. So there's been an increase in the use of animals in education. And interestingly, in 2009, they separated out the categories of invasiveness that those animals used in education fell under, which they didn't do for 2011. I don't know why they didn't separate out categories. But in 2009, there were 22,787 animals in category D for education and 449 in category E. Personally, I feel that's unacceptable. I don't think you should have to do animals in category E procedures for your education. Majority of those in category E were fish and pigs, hence the pictures. Sorry, farm animals. Not specifically fish and farm animals. So, what are the implications of traditional animal use in education? And just to say, CCAC only covers post-secondary institutions. It won't cover dissection in high school. Okay. First off, is harm to animals. It's kind of obvious. There's the killing of animals for educational purposes, which may not actually carry as much pedagogical merit, as it may not meet the learning outcomes as effectively as non-animal models. It creates a somewhat poor learning environment. So you can have technical problems in surgeries or in dissections. Actual physical structures can be very unclear. You don't get a chance to repeat the procedure because it's kind of, you don't want to reuse animals, which is a good thing, but you, as a student who's learning, you don't get to repeat. It can bring up negative emotions, and some of those emotions might be things like withdrawal or compassion fatigue of students. There's well-documented effects of desensitization of compassion through in-depth students throughout their training. There's also this kind of strange phenomenon where there'll be an accentuation of the positive. So students will joke around with animal body parts and objectify and try and make crass humorous, trying to make light of a situation that they're actually feeling is emotional. So there's complex emotions that arise when using animals for education. There's an infringement of civil liberties. It is a person's right to not use animals in their education if they want to. But if you feel like there will be some kind of penalty for not complying with this kind of norm of using animals, then you might go along with something that you really don't agree with for personal ethical or religious reasons. Interestingly, I feel like there's a loss to science. I think that one of the conversations I had with my computer science professor about my struggle with using animals in research, and specifically in my education, he was like, well, you know, just think about it really hard, because you have the kind of people who want to stay in the field, because you have that connection. And it was kind of this really interesting dilemma for me, right? So sometimes you lose these really critical thinkers in science, and people that would be really progressive in their thought, because they would just think, well, this isn't the discipline for me if I have to use animals, even at this point in my first, second, third year of undergraduate. And then there's this desensitization, which propagates the norms that we've just heard about from the work that's going on also using animals in research, beyond an undergraduate career. Those norms have become entrenched, because I think that, again, there's a desensitization that happens over the course of undergraduate training that involves using live animals. Okay. So, given all of that, what would be my advice on conscientious objection? I think, I don't know whether any of the students in the room are in biology programs where this is what you're facing, but before we need to pass, and I, but I'm dissenting from this, but I am not going to take part. You can say, well, you know, this is a problem for me, here's an alternative, can we implement the alternative, I'll help. Okay, so be active in your objection to these animals in your training. There are myriad alternatives to animals in education. I personally really strongly feel it's a personal use that could really reduce if not stopped very soon. There are films and videos, models, managers, simulations, multimedia computer simulations. Like I was online this morning just looking up some of this stuff, and you can do frog dissection just online. It's free. And it's not someone actually working with an animal, it's computer generated images. You can talk to the university about ethically sourced animal cadavers and tissue. So there are animals that die naturally, those companion animals that are euthanized at the end of their life. Some universities in the United States have veterinary schools that are set up with local vet clinics so that any tissues from end of life patients can just be used. And there's like a body donation program for animals with humans with clinical work with patients, so whether they're human patients or animal patients, there's a lot of work that can be done under close supervision with a supervisor. In physiology or med school, student self-experimentation, like I don't mean anything too radical, but for things like taking pulses or the effects of diuretics, things that are pretty harmless, you could just, and there's something really engaging about happening with you and your peers instead of using animals to figure that out. You get that kind of, well, there's an embodied experience of learning, and there's also this self-interest, right? Like we're all interested in what animals do. In vitro labs, so in vitro work is thankfully really taking off a lot of it. It's used to replace these animals, in science. And so being well versed in vitro technology is probably wise for any science student. Fields of science going forward. And field studies where you just go and observe and measure what they actually do. So as part of my master's degree, I went and did some kind of like observation that was really minimally disruptive. One website that I would like to talk about is called InterNiche. A lot of the material for this talk I got from Olivia Berryville, so I just want to acknowledge that. Olivia is the Canadian contact for InterNiche, which is basically an international resource on humane education. So this is the website, InterNiche.org. And this is just a screenshot. On the table there, that's a mannequin, that's a dog, a mannequin that's being looked at by students. The resources provided by InterNiche are, there's a free book to download on getting back to computing, that was kind of the transition to alternatives. There's an alternatives in education